Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Don't Forget Me, a lifeline of hope for those touched by substance abuse and addiction, by Steve M. Grant, narrated by Peter Lerman. Introduction. In light of the recent opioid epidemic, there are countless articles, stories, television shows, and movies about addiction and the repercussions of it. This story is different. It is different because it is mine. When addiction hits home, everything changes. Statistics could not move me, but my sons could. Epidemics did not scare me, but seeing my sons struggle with an illness would. News stories lacked the power to compel me to action, but my children's story did. When a life is touched by addiction, it's not about statistics. It is about people. In this case, these people are my sons, Chris and Kelly. This is not a story about statistics and epidemics. This is a story about being a parent, about loving someone struggling with substance use, and about loss. It is also a story about what comes after loss, what, if anything, rises from the ashes of grief. It is a story about recovery. This is a story about hope and knowing that none of us ever has to walk alone. Disclaimer. As I have written this story, I want to honor the truth that I can only tell from my point of view. I have done my very best to fact-check everything that is recorded in these pages and to share the story of my sons faithfully. That said, I acknowledge that each story is told from my perspective, and everything contained herein is told through the lens of how I see and remember them. Any omissions, errors, and oversights are due to my imperfect memory. No ill will is intended to anyone in any regard. There are 5 occasions in this book where profanity is referenced. I do not wish to be offensive or gratuitous in the use of expletives. I want to be true to the struggles and challenges that we faced and convey the truth of the lives we lived at the time. Understanding that some of those who listen to this book may be in recovery from substance use disorders, I do want to acknowledge that there are some references to drug use that could be triggering for some. Although these descriptions are not overly graphic, they are honest, and I would not want any listeners to be caught unaware. Lastly, whenever possible, I have sought to honor the anonymity and confidentiality of others in this story. In that regard, I have attempted to not specifically reference individuals who are in recovery or actively using substances or any treatment centers by name. Beginnings. Getting started. I was born in New York City and lived in the area until 18 years of age in Paramus, New Jersey. My twin brother Anthony and I are the oldest siblings. We have a younger brother, Freddie. I also had a younger sister named Robin. Growing up, I was an exceptionally average student, but I found a bit of a niche for myself in athletics with both basketball and baseball. My younger years were unexceptional for the most part. We walked to high school daily and stayed out of any major trouble. Following high school, I attended Furman University on a small baseball scholarship and graduated in 1980. During my sophomore year of college, my younger sister died in a car accident at the age of 18. I recall riding with my family to identify her body near the Jersey Shore and my mother crying throughout the round trip. After that, things began to change within my family. Growing up, we had alcohol in our basement. It was essentially the same bottles for years. After my sister's death, the bottles began to change. During that time, my father manufactured mink coats in the garment district in New York City, which meant he left early and came home late. Mom began drinking while Dad was at work. This was not new for her family, just for her. My mom's mother drank alcohol daily and was seldom seen without a shot glass. My mom's brother died in his 50s from alcoholism. Her youngest brother was told by his doctor that if he drank again, he could die. That was over 30 years ago, and he hasn't had a drink since. My mom's drinking should not have come as a shock, considering the family's history. Fortunately, Mom was able to quit drinking with some treatment and support. Our family tree was watered, in part, by alcohol. I continued my education at Furman and was captain of the baseball team in both my junior and senior years. After I graduated from college, I worked for my father for 6 months in New York, and during that time, I married a young woman named Mary, whom I met at Furman. She was from Connecticut, about an hour away from where we lived, and we married in 1981. Mary and I moved to Greenville, South Carolina in February of 1982, where I began working in the financial services business. From that perspective, the story sounds pretty linear, and as though everything worked out well. I wish that I could tell you that was the case. Mary was from an upper-middle-class family and was one of six kids. She fell in the middle of the birth order. She was teased mercilessly at times growing up, which probably did not do a great deal to build her sense of self-worth. Once we were married, I attempted to stand up for her at times with her family, but my attempts fell on deaf ears. Not only was Mary's family a little wealthier and teased more fiercely than mine, but they also had another identifying feature. The family drank more regularly than mine. They didn't drink to excess at that time. They typically had a few martinis after work. Faced with this, I did what any self-respecting son-in-law would do. I began drinking martinis too. Mary had a real knack for languages and spoke three. She was working outside of the home when we learned we were expecting our first child. On May 16, 1984, we had a beautiful baby boy, and we named him Christopher. After his birth, she was a full-time homemaker. I vividly recall a conversation we had in our driveway upon bringing Chris home. I told Mary that we had committed an unselfish act in having our son, and that we had to make him the center of our family. From that point forward, I essentially put Mary after Chris. When our second son, Kelly, was born on May 12, 1986, Mary moved to third place in terms of my priorities. I vividly remember this conversation and this attitude because both of them were equally, phenomenally wrong. Children are an amazing gift, and they have a powerful impact on families. They do not fare well as the center of a household. Children need a secure base to grow on and launch from. They can't be that base for themselves or for their parents. In that regard, I was putting unreasonable expectations on Chris before he ever arrived. Secondly, placing a child ahead of a spouse is a recipe for disaster. When we do that, we are inviting a child to play one parent against the other. This is not because the child is bad. It's because that's part of being a child. By putting Mary in second place to our children, I placed a wedge between us without even knowing it. It was a mistake made in ignorance, but ignorance does not release us from experiencing the repercussions of our choices. It's an occupational hazard of being human. There are no perfect parents, and Mary and I were no exception. We made sure the boys brushed their teeth every night. We signed report cards. We all went to church every week. The early years were relatively peaceful in our household. In retrospect, it was the calm before the storm, but it was a wonderful time of making memories together. The cracks were already there, but they had not yet begun to show. That would soon change. Having a child is an unselfish act, and now we had the challenge and privilege of raising this child. The problem is that rather than my wife and I being the center of the wheel with our children rotating around a solid, secure center, our children became the hub. Expecting. When a couple conceives and is preparing to have a child, one of the words used to describe the process is that the couple is expecting. Truer words may have never been spoken. From the moment I became aware that we would be having a child, I began expecting. I expected Christopher would be athletic and would make the teams he tried out for with all that would entail. I expected he would be a good student, would be outgoing, would share my faith, and a world of other things. I was expecting every bit as much as Mary was. To have a child is to see one's hopes take on a physical form. That is a frightening thing for a parent to be, but it is also a tremendous burden for the little one who has not even arrived on the scene. They are about to be born into a world of expectations. Some of the expectations that we hold for our children are met, and some are not. Frustration is the distance between the two. One of the hallmarks of a healthy parent is that we learn to love our children through the disappointment, to love them for who they are, and not devalue them because of who we expected they would be. That is the kind of father I wanted to be, and it is the kind of father I have learned to become. I'm getting a bit ahead of myself. Let me tell you about my sons. Christopher, our firstborn. Christopher Roberts Grant was born on May 16, 1984. He was our firstborn, and I suppose in retrospect we indulged him. He basically had a normal childhood, and Mary and I were blissfully oblivious as to the challenges of childhood and what that might entail. When Chris went to five-year-old kindergarten, we packed all of our hopes and dreams into the book bag with him, the same way that most every parent does. Of course, it did not take long before we got our first glimpse that things may be a little different than we had anticipated. When we met Chris's 5K teacher about his moving up to first grade in the fall, she suggested that he might benefit from repeating his current grade. She suggested that he was a little wild, and even said that he was a prime candidate for Ritalin. We knew he was energetic, but the rest came as a bit of a shock. Being held back in kindergarten was not as common then as it is now, and it came with a healthy amount of stigma. We were not eager for him to start out with the deck stacked against him. But even so, we wanted to explore this with Chris. Mary and I agreed that I would take the lead in talking to him. I gave it a lot of thought and prepared what I believed was a fairly smooth response. I looked at my five-year-old son and said, "Christopher, your teacher loves you so much that she wants to teach you again next year." Without missing a beat, Chris looked up at me with big, trusting eyes and asked, "Will my friends still be in my class?" I paused a moment, then replied that his teacher wanted him to stay with her. Chris responded matter-of-factly, "Well then, I don't want to do that then." I was the man of the house. Mary and I were the parents, and Chris was the child. We responded accordingly by changing schools so that he wouldn't know that he was staying in the same grade. To make it possible for Chris to be able to move to a new school, multiple things would have to happen, and those things seemed unlikely to fall into place. Nonetheless, I watched in amazement as everything worked out as though by divine intervention. Mary was asked to take on a teaching job at the other school, and she accepted the position on the condition that Chris would be able to come to the school with her. They agreed. Chris started there that fall and stayed at this school through the ninth grade. He made a lot of close friends there and began to spread his wings a bit as he grew. As a father, it was exciting to see. Although Chris was often popular and seemed to have many friends, school was not without its challenges. Academics seemed to come easy for some kids, but that wasn't always the case for Chris. It was not that Chris wasn't smart, he was extremely bright. Chris struggled to keep organized and often didn't remember to turn in his assignments even after he completed them. His level of ability wasn't the issue. Most teachers chalked it up as a lack of effort or the need to focus. Teacher comments on report cards and evaluations during this time often included references to his not giving his best work and not paying attention in class. Nonetheless, he continued to do well enough to pass and move through his academic years and advanced year after year until he finally reached his teens. While Chris was 14 and in eighth grade, two things happened. One was his confirmation into the church. The other was that he began using alcohol and other drugs for the first time. Chris's confirmation was met with incredible support both from family and friends. Chris's church basketball coach served as his sponsor for confirmation. He was important to Chris and consistently showed care and support for him. I have the confirmation letter that Mary and I wrote to him, acknowledging his compassionate heart towards his great maternal grandmother. I have the letter that his maternal granddad wrote to him, sending him a picture of his own confirmation. In it, my father-in-law mentioned the first baseball game that he ever went to, a doubleheader between the Dodgers and Cardinals at Ebbets Field. That connection to baseball ran deep through the family and made its way to Chris as well. While Chris did not always shine in the classroom, he did shine in other areas. For one, Chris seemed to have a natural penchant for theater. He was cast in two different roles during his school years. One was as a DJ who ran a school in a popular play. Essentially, for 90 minutes, Chris got to dance and move to the music as the DJ. This was a stroke of genius on the part of the director. Chris had trouble standing still at the best of times. One of Chris's liabilities was turned into an asset. He also starred in Forrest Gump as Forrest. In both roles, Chris seemed to have a natural talent and excelled. He also excelled in math. Chris demonstrated natural talent on the athletic field. That was not entirely a surprise. After all, with my legacy of athleticism, I was sure he was destined for greatness. Chris, like me, had a natural bend toward athletics, but it took some time to manifest itself. I had been the same way. My passion had been for baseball as a child as well. But early on, I was the kid who volunteered to play on the other team when they didn't have enough players. It killed my parents that I had so much love for the game, but could not hit a Volkswagen if it had been pitched to me before I was 12. Then one day, it was as though a light came on and I was able to hit. The same thing happened with Chris. He started slowly, but he got better quickly as he got older. I even coached his team from the time that he was young and was, in many ways, one of his biggest cheerleaders. Later, Chris excelled in soccer. We spent Thanksgiving in Atlanta and Christmas in Orlando for tournaments. Either Mary or I went with him. We didn't go as a family because Kelly had no interest in it. We went the route that was easier for everybody, but the choice separated our family. We never did anything as a family. I did things with Chris and Mary did things with Kelly, but it was never the four of us. Despite his natural inclination to athletics, sometimes his effort was not as strong as it could have been. Chris didn't always see how gifted he was athletically, and because of that, he did not always apply himself as strongly as he could have. This is a trait I'm afraid he came by honestly, as I often heard the same thing both growing up and in my work life as I grew older as well. The reality was that although Chris had a world of potential in him, he never seemed to feel at ease in his skin. It was as though he was acting in his own life at times instead of living it. He seemed to think that he had to be someone other than himself to be liked or loved by others. When he looked in the mirror, he simply didn't see what I and others saw. This was not always clear, but I was about to get a crash course on how he saw himself. School days and Friday nights. Although we did not know it at the time, Chris often felt awkward in social situations. As I mentioned before, he didn't seem to feel at home in his own skin and struggled socially at times, even though he was generally well-liked and popular. One day, a customer said to me, "I understand your son is a drunk. Great athlete, but he's a drunk." He wouldn't tell me who told him about Chris's drinking, but I thought, that's an interesting comment. Maybe something was going on. I would have loved to have known how the person that told me my son was a drunk knew. If he wasn't going to reveal the source, why did he make the statement? If I had known who it had come from, I might have believed it. It is incredibly difficult to get to the point where you're ready to face the seriousness of the situation. I thought he was being a teenager, doing what boys do. Chris medicated his feelings of anxiety. We later learned that as early as eighth grade, Chris had begun drinking alcohol before Friday night football games. We were oblivious at first, but we were starting to follow a path of breadcrumbs towards the truth. Of course, some of these breadcrumbs were more obvious than others. One of the first appeared when we were having the carpets cleaned at the house. After they finished, one of the workers mentioned that there were a lot of beer cans under our couch. Beer cans? Under the couch at our house? Apparently, they were magic beer cans because not a soul in our home had any idea how they had gotten there. That made no sense to me at the time, but it was one of the first steps down the trail. It was around this time that Mary and I would go out of town on occasion and entrust the house to our sons for the evening. We had the sense that there were people over and parties being hosted by them in our absence. We made it abundantly clear there was to be no one over while we were gone. When Mary and I came home after our next trip, I was, frankly, pleasantly surprised that the house seemed to be in order. I even checked the garbage can and under the furniture and saw no evidence that concerned me. Sometimes a father has a bit of a sixth sense, and leaving well enough alone had never been my strength. There was a tall fence at the back of our property, slightly taller than me. I decided to go and have a look at the other side. I got the ladder and went to the back of the yard, climbed up, and looked over. I was slack-jawed. On the other side of the fence, there were trash bags full of beer cans and stacks of empty pizza boxes. I decided to have a word with my son. Chris, of course, denied having any idea how the cans and boxes got there. He responded with a perfectly reasonable sounding, "I couldn't eat that much pizza." I pointed out that he couldn't alone, but that he possibly could with help from his friends. Still, he denied it. Denial in the face of the obvious was to become a recurring theme in our household. It occurred to me that there might be a way to get some additional clarity about this particular situation. I retrieved one of the boxes and took it to the pizza company where it was purchased. I had coached the owner's son in baseball, and we had remained friends. I explained that some boxes had been dropped on my property and asked if they could scan the barcode and let me know who had purchased the pizza. They scanned the box and then proceeded to give my son's name, our address, and the amount he had paid for the order. Even though the breadcrumbs were obvious, Chris initially denied that they were his or that he knew anything about them. Other crumbs were more subtle. I began to notice white spots, flecks, really, on the kitchen floor. These spots were small, and they were extremely difficult to get up. I tried to figure out where they were coming from, but I couldn't put a finger on it. Later, I finally realized that it was from a bottle of scotch. When drops would fall on the floor and dry, they left behind the hard white spots. Chris had inadvertently been dripping alcohol on the floor when he and his friends were drinking, and these little spots were like small crumbs of evidence.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.